a particular programming campaign running about that. And he's going to talk a little bit more about that in just a minute and then introduce our guest panelists. But I want to explain first how this is going to work. So if you notice up here at the front, there are four panelists on the hot seats, and there are four empty chairs. So this is called a tag dialogue. So these folks are going to start talking, and you may never tag them out of the conversation. They are going to remain the constant. But what they're going to do is they're going to talk a little bit about their experience, and LGBT immigration is an important issue in our movement. And then for the first four vacant chairs, you in the audience will come up and occupy these chairs by way of engaging in this conversation. So what we get to witness is really kind of like a fishbowl scenario. In part, if you're in the audience, you get to watch the dialogue that's going up here. But at any point in time, you can come and tag people in these other chairs. They will go sit down, and you will be central to the dialogue and the discussion that's going on. Did that make sense? Anybody like totally confused? Yes, you're confused. Okay. Let me just borrow you for a second, if I could. Remind me your name.
Jake,
come on up. Have a seat.
Most exciting and leading thinking on this work happening to integrate LGBT and immigrant rights and the common agendas and the uncommon stories that make up individuals working in this movement. And in speaking of stories, we have four really amazing stories here today. The four panelists we're going to hear from: Tania Unzueta with the Immigrant Youth Justice League and the Association of Latino Men for Action; Reyna Wences, Immigrant Youth Justice League; Juan Rodriguez, Students Working for Equal Rights; and Felipe Matos, Presente.org and Students Working for Equal Rights. They also happen to be, and here's the big news, guys, the first, four of the first winners of the Freedom from Fear Award National Prize for uncommon heroes and unsung heroes doing uncommon, courageous acts on behalf of immigrants in America. The Freedom from Fear Awards. Let's give it up for them. The Freedom from Fear Awards are going to be announced at the Netroots Nation closing plenary this Saturday night with a star-studded cast of characters on stage, entertainment, and some of the winners. You can go to Freedom from Fear Awards. Were launched earlier this year, and through a really robust social networking campaign, we got 380 nominations for unsung heroes in this country, regular people doing courageous acts on behalf of immigrants. You don't have to realize that immigrant rights in this country, it's a really tough story right now. There's some really horrible things happening in Arizona, in states in the South, an explosion and proliferation of anti-immigrant laws passing through state legislatures. Well, four of those winners are here right now, and we will now hear from them as they lead the conversation on the common struggle of LGBT people and immigrants in America. Thank you very much.
Happy birthday, dear Reyna. Happy birthday to you.
Say that I'm really honored to be here. A lot of the people in this audience are people who I admire a lot, you know, and I want to also point out Yahaira, who is not sitting here with us, but who's also queer, who's a dreamer, who is in the forefront of the fight for the Dream Act and immigrant rights as well, and I just wanted to give her a shout out. I was asked to talk about LGBTQ and immigrant rights, and for me, that's a very difficult topic because I don't see the difference between one and the other, because it plays out in my personal life as just one continuous story, right? I came to the United States when I was 14 years old from Brazil. Any Brazilians here? Didn't think so. I'm usually the only one, so. I came here because my mother was very sick back in Brazil, And she had to make a very difficult choice of whether to pretty much keep me there or send me over to live with family members in the US. So she decided to kind of like make me go. And I'll never forget those 8 hours in that, you know, plane and crying and feeling like, oh my God, what am I getting myself into? You know, I was 14 years old. And that was also more or less at the time that I was already starting to struggle with my identity as a queer man. And I had to face all of that alone in a foreign country, you know, not knowing the language and everything like that. And as I, you know, I finally arrived in the US, and it's a very strange topic for me to even talk about poverty, because the poverty that I experienced back in Brazil is so foreign to so many Americans in the US. What it means to be in extreme poverty, not have a sewer, not have water, not have electricity, you know, struggle for food every day. And then over here, you know, you go to the Publix, I mean, Publix is a grocery store in Florida, and you have like five brands of milk. That was like, whoa, you know, like things like that, right? Or air conditioning in school, that was another thing. And growing up in the US, having to face the concept of not having papers and not really understanding what would it mean for me to not have a visa on my passport, and growing up with my peers and not really like noticing it until I had to go to college. And at that point, I remember I was in 11th grade, I was really depressed, and I had to confront my undocumented status because I was forced into, and then at the same time, I was afraid of coming out as queer because I was afraid of my family kicking me out of the house. And I wouldn't have anywhere to go because I couldn't turn to the police. I couldn't turn to anywhere. There is no social protection for immigrants in the US when you don't have papers or very little. And it took me until I turned 22 years old and I finally found independent economic independence for my family for me to have finally the courage to come out as queer. So I actually came out as undocumented when I was like 19 years old for the very first time. And it took me all the way until I was 22 to be able to come out as queer. And when I did, I remember talking to my older sister, and the first thing that she told me is, well, great, now you're gonna be hated twice. You know, you're already hated because you're an immigrant. You're hated because you don't have your papers. You're hated because, I mean, here in Miami, we live comfortably, but every time we go to North Carolina on our vacations, people close their doors on you because you don't look like everyone else. And now you're gonna be hated because you're queer. And, you know, and she cried because she thought I was gonna get killed. It was like it was a very dramatic experience. And I had to confront that reality because I actually raised the point of the police working directly with immigration right now. And that was what she told me. She was like, well, where are you gonna go if they hurt you? There's nowhere for you. There's nothing you can do. You're powerless. And I, you know, obviously hugged her, you know, she was crying, and told her that everything was gonna be fine, but, you know, I was scared. But I still did it. I came out, I told my family, I told my parents, I told everyone. And then one day I went on TV and I said that I didn't have papers, and then little like not too long after, I was like, oh, I'm with Juan, he was right there. Juan is my partner, and you know, doing both things on TV was like crazy because everybody in my neighborhood already knew that I didn't have papers. Then they found out I didn't have, you know, that I was queer, and it just became a mess. So I am not able to adjust my status as my immigration status because I can't get married. And for immigration law, that's not seen as a way for me to resolve my paperwork, right? So the United American Families Act would benefit me personally, but it wouldn't benefit another person who I wanted to talk about. I'm not gonna mention his name, he asked me not to. He's from North Carolina. And Moses, Maria, came when she was 2 years old. And She came here from Mexico, and she was brought when she was 2 years old, a little baby, and she crossed the border, right, with her family. When you cross the border, even if you get married, you're not able to adjust your status. So let's say Wafa was to pass to dying. Maria would not be able to benefit from this. The only thing that she could benefit from is either the Dream Act or some sort of immigration reform. And so she came when she was two from Mexico, and she grew up in the United States in a little town with 2,000 people. And the other day I went there, I was there, that's how I met her, and she told me, asked her, well, do you want to come out? Do you want help? What can I do to help you out, you know, in the situation? And she said, Felipe, let me be honest with you. Being brown here means you're hated. And hatred, that means, you know, the people come and they vandalize your house, they vandalize your church, they hurt you in the street, you know, she said that she grew up being called a wetback and, you know, just different slurs. And she wasn't ready. She said, I am not ready to come out as queer. There is absolutely no way for me to be able to deal with both things at the same time in this 2,000 people town. And that's happening all over the United States, right? Where undocumented immigrants who grew up in the US, who could have benefited from the Dream Act or from other legislation that could have passed, you know, and, you know, it didn't pass last December, fortunately. And they have to deal with the reality of living in a small rural town with no help from anyone, and being undocumented brown and queer is a lot more than you can think of, especially in a place like that. And then finally, I also wanted to talk about Ricky in Jacksonville, Florida. Ricky is actually, I met him because of Facebook. Facebook, Twitter, yay, right? He came to me because we were walking, and then he was like, well, you know, it's so great what you're doing, whatever. And I came to, he told me his story. He said that he came at the age of 17. He crossed the border from Guatemala running away from his dad. That his dad was very abusive. He was a ballet dancer. He was in an art academy in Guatemala. And that there is a lot of really homophobic countries all over the world. Guatemala is one. I mean, there are like death squads in Colombia that literally go around looking for people that look quote unquote gay, and they kill them. And he was dealing with that. And his dad was so abusive, and he couldn't go to the police because the police didn't care. So he crossed the border, he came to the United States, and he was arrested 3 times, not because of anything that he did, but because he's brown. So, you know, like he was crossing the street and they arrest him for the first time. He was in the grocery store, and they accused him of stealing, I think, a can of like something. And he was arrested a second time. So he was arrested 3 times for things like that. That he didn't do anything wrong. It was just like, you know, for being brown. And that all came against him when he was trying to seek asylum. And it took him 15 years to finally get asylum and thousands of dollars that he didn't really have. So, I mean, it's really complicated how people become undocumented, you know, and how people can adjust their status. Right now, there's very few ways that people can do it. I mean, and pretty much once you become undocumented, it's almost impossible for you to be able to get that. And one last issue that I wanted to like raise, which is related to the police and being a person of color. Not only, I think that affects Latino citizens and non-citizens too, and also the African American community a lot right now, which is the zero tolerance in high schools. If you get in touch with the police right now, that's deportation, right? So when I had to confront the fact that I was undocumented, and I had nowhere to go to talk about being queer, I got really angry, more angry than actually sad. And in that anger, I was in detention. You know, I mean, like, I don't know how many of you got into detention in school. I was in detention like 3 times. Because I was skipping class, you know what I mean, like in my junior year. And thank God at that time, you know, zero tolerance wasn't as enforceable in Florida. But, you know, once you were an undocumented immigrant And you have to live with this reality. I mean, people react in different ways. And zero tolerance turned people in. Well, let's say that the Obama administration has turned the police into immigration agents in most places. So all of this young people are actually getting turned over to immigration and being deported for being, you know, for not having a place to go to. And that's not fair. So I wanted to like really talk, just like mention that. And just finish off with this remark. It was actually a friend of mine that I was talking to her, and then I was just saying, you know, look, you know, all of these things have been happening. I don't know what to do. And then she told me, well, you know, you should go to, should look for LGBTQ group, you know, like back when I was in high school. And then she said, well, you should go to them because the LGBTQ community should be the most inclusive out of all communities, because we are everywhere, right? We are everywhere. I mean, I've walked from Miami to Washington, D.C., town to town, place to place, and I knocked a lot of doors. I not only found undocumented immigrants in every town I went to, but I also found queer people in every single town I went to. Every color, every shape, every shade, you know, and what I guess like what I wanted to say is that I think I feel like I belong here, and you and us belong to each other, right? On our daily struggle, and what we need to do right now is to try to broaden the scope of our reach to get the Marias in the 2,000, you know, villages in the middle of nowhere, North Carolina, to get to Rick in Jacksonville, to get to the Felipes in Miami, or, you know, everywhere, so we can make sure that this room can really represent the not only the identities, but the struggles of LGBTQ, the entire LGBTQ community. Thanks.
Good afternoon. My name is Reyna Wences, and I'm undocumented. I guess I just want to share a little bit of background information on where I come from and how I got here today. So I'm originally from Mexico City. I was born there about 20 years ago. No, 20 years ago I was born there. And it was about 11 years ago that my family decided to come to the U.S. because even though my mom was a teacher for 14 years in Mexico, and even though my stepfather had a company and he was an engineer, it just wasn't enough. Like, the company went bankrupt. I think that if I get more into it now that I know about history and about legislation and stuff that happened, I can connect my stepfather's business going going bankrupt because of like legislations and like stuff that was passed, such as NAFTA, which left a lot of people in Mexico without a job. And so eventually we were just basically pushed to come to the U.S. And my brother was 3 years old at the time. And actually, he's graduating today, so congratulations to him. I know that they're recording this, so I just wanted to say that. anyway, and so I started fourth grade here. My mom always told me, you know, go to school, you're a good student, you'll be able to do whatever you want. I always wanted to either be a teacher, archaeologist, I had all these dreams, right? And then eventually I got to high school. I learned English, I ended up at one of the best high schools in the country, and then I realized that me trying and my education and my dreams were not enough because I'm undocumented, right? And so when I started looking for applications and scholarships for school, there were some, and there are some, but they were very limited. And every time I would look at a college application and it would say social security number, I knew that I couldn't produce it. So what I would do is just put it away. I didn't want to deal with it. It's a pain, it hurts, and it's also very, I got really angry because I knew that I was just as good as any other of my classmates at school, that I could score, I had the good grades. I think that I deserved to go to the schools where I wanted to go to. And so once I got accepted and some of them were giving me some money, I kind of realized that
the anger.
I guess I, yeah. I actually had to turn down some schools because it just wasn't enough. Like, even though some schools were giving me money and half of full rides and everything, it's just it's not enough because the resources for undocumented students are not there, for undocumented youth in general. And so when I was in high school, my senior year, I started getting really depressed because application after application, scholarship after scholarship, then excuse and lie after lie that I had to tell all my friends and my teachers. I remember telling my French teacher that I couldn't go to Quebec because my grandpa was visiting that day, that week. I remember telling my friends that I couldn't get a driver's license because I can't afford a car right now, so why would I even try to get a driver's license, right? And so all for 10 years I lied, I made up excuses, and my senior year of high school I started getting really, really angry, really upset, really depressed, and I tried to commit suicide a day after my graduation. So about 2 years ago, and actually my graduation was June 13th, and that's when I did it. Because I felt alone, because I started thinking, the funeral is probably cheaper than paying for tuition, where the school that I wanted to go to was $40,000. I just was thinking about my family, and nothing happened, and I'm here, and I'm really lucky for that. But at the same time, as I was getting over my depression and trying to look for people that I could talk to, I started actually finding people like Tania and other undocumented youth that started helping me talk about being undocumented. So that helped me a lot. But then I also started realizing that, you know, that I wasn't the only one, that this is probably something that happened to me, and I felt alone, and I remember how it happened. But I also remember that there are other people out there that are not undocumented and that are probably thinking the same thing because they've also experienced discrimination. And I'm talking about the people in the LGBT community. Because even though I was privileged enough not to feel scared about coming out as queer when I was growing up, and I actually came out as queer first before I came out as undocumented, I know that feeling is, it's hard to deal with it. And if I'm, now that I'm here and I have the time to talk to all of you, I would like to ask you to please consider and think about if you've ever had an experience about coming out, if I've experienced fear, to think about how it feels to be alone, to realize that same feeling is affecting other people. And for me, it's affecting undocumented youth that do not want to come out of the shadows, because in the media they are criminalizing us, they're calling us different names, they're accusing us for things that we're not even doing. So I just wanted to ask everyone to please consider and think about how connected we are, because we are really connected. We do share this coming out, right? Like, we as undocumented people, we say we're coming out of the shadows, and actually that's something that we took from the gay rights movement in the 1970s when they were coming out, right? Coming out. And so I feel that we used to think, when we started planning the whole like coming out of the shadows day, which is March 10th, we got really inspired by Harvey Milk, because he said, you know, you have to come out to your friends, you have to come out to your parents, and you have to destroy the myths. And I think that that's what we're trying to do here. And I hope that we can all come out, not only as queers, as undocumented people, but also as allies. And I think that everyone in this room, if you know and you have come out, I think that you can say that you're also an ally to the undocumented youth, because you know how it feels to be empowered by coming out. So thank you.
So, I feel like a lot of things overlap. My name is Juan Rodriguez. I'm an immigrant from Colombia. I was born in Bogota, Colombia, and came to the U.S. with my family when I was 6 years old, fleeing persecution, and, you know, trying to find stability in what was painted as the land of opportunity, the land of freedom, the land of everything all over the world. And so for me, you know, part of why I felt like really honored and blessed to be here is because I barely ever have a chance to speak in a forum where I can be like a complete person. I feel like I've gone through my entire life having my struggle as an immigrant and my struggle as a queer man, and those things being completely divided and set apart in silos, and I could either talk about one or talk about the other in certain spaces, and then the other would always be excluded. It just really building a lot of anger and resentment throughout my life of how I've imposed that type of division and exclusion within myself. So, you know, just thinking back on my life, in my junior year of high school, when I felt ready to come out in my school and start telling my friends about my identity, it was also the same time that I was preparing myself to go to universities and started getting demands for my social security number and my green card and my visa and like all of these terms that I didn't understand at all because they had never been explained to me. I had no idea how to gain access to them, where to find them, or and especially didn't understand what that had anything to do with my ability to get somewhere, to succeed. You know, I was always told if you work hard and you prove your worth, you prove how willing you are to fight for something, then you'll be able to get it. But at the end of my high school, as I was coming out, at the same time I had to see how, you know, it didn't matter like what my grades were, what my contributions to society were, everything always came back to, do you have a social security number or not? If not, you don't exist. And so many youth that I've met since then who keep being told that they're completely insignificant or non-existent because they don't have that number, because they never got that letter in the mail, some plastic card that somehow validates whether they're like worth being acknowledged in this country. And you know, and then approaching my graduation, my father went out to get groceries for the family one day, and he got stopped by an officer who just thought that he looked suspicious. And in Florida, it became a felony to drive without a license, and licenses stopped being issued to people who were undocumented in 2003. And so a few weeks before my graduation, my dad was taken, and he was put in jail for 8 months for driving without a license. And he missed my graduation, which I had, for me, like she mentioned, I couldn't have been more depressed, not only because I felt like I was hitting a brick wall, but because, you know, struggling with my gender identity, I've always had a huge like gap between in my relationship with my father, who never communicated with me, never responded to me. And I worked throughout my entire life to try to make him proud and try to be able to go up on stage and show him my diploma. And when I finally made it up there, not only did I feel like I didn't have a future, but the one person who needed to be in the crowd wasn't there. And so, you know, waiting for him to come back, only being able to interact with him over the phone once a week, and my baby sister being born while he was in jail, and him not being able to be there for her in her first few months of life, and then coming back and opening up to him about being queer and my identity and what that meant for my life, and you know, from the Latin culture, him just telling me that that was wrong and unacceptable, and that if I lived in his house, it had to be under his rules and on his terms, and if not, then I had to leave. And so I ended up having to move out of my house, rented a room in a place a few miles away, and being undocumented, I couldn't find employment, so I went back to my school begging to my high school teachers to let me do any type of work for them. And so they let me do gardening work at their houses. They knew apartment buildings that needed a janitor, and so I went and did that in the evenings. They took me into their classrooms and I could grade their papers so that they could give me whatever cash they could under the table. And that's pretty much how I survived for the first few months after I basically ran away from home. And so for me, it's being a part of this struggle hasn't only been about my own particular journey in that. I mean, the Trail of Dreams itself, the walk from Miami to Washington, D.C., you know, aside from being something to try to get the the topic of immigration back on the agenda and trying to show the sacrifices of immigrants who were doing so much to give back to their communities and who had so much love for this country and for being, you know, trying to be given an opportunity. Fundamentally, it was inspired because of stories like Reyna and because of the fear that I had of my own sense of hope and my own sense of purpose in this world. And hearing more and more about cases of students who were taking their lives and those cases being recorded because they were undocumented, because they were queer, because they couldn't find a place to fit in, a network to talk to, someone who told them that it was okay for them to be themselves. And so in the organizing work that we do at Students Working for Equal Rights and in Florida, we've seen how crucial it's been to build that consciousness about the intersections of all of these struggles. And seeing that, you know, these issues about exclusion and being seen as a threat to mankind and trying to move around the world looking for safety, looking for stability, looking for some sort of permanence, that's something that goes across the board with every human being. And it's, you know, all of us are in that journey. And so for me, it's, I feel like a lot of the work I've been trying to do and that I want to be more intentional in doing is in figuring out how anybody involved in social justice work can help be an ally in creating those safe spaces where everyone can learn more about the history of the peoples that, of their families and their people that have migrated across the world seeking opportunities and fleeing persecution and being able to work towards freedom of expression and freedom to be whoever it is that we are. And so, you know, I've seen like huge transformations, not just in the queer individuals in our organization who found that safe space to come out and assert their identities in that way, but also the changes in the straight people in our organization and many of the straight men that came in very machista, very patriarchal and violent. And over the years in their interactions with me, with Felipe, with other queer undocumented students in the organization, being able to learn more about themselves and their own struggle with their own identities. And so one of the things I was telling Felipe is, you know, I woke up today and almost cried because I got a text message from one of my lifelong friends. His name is Alex. He's a US citizen, African-American male. I mean, we led entirely different lives throughout all the time that we were friends and that we knew each other. But, you know, the day that he found out about my struggle being undocumented, being banned from universities, being held back, he started an immigrant rights chapter at his college. And even when he graduated and went to Oregon, he kept on volunteering with immigrant rights coalitions in Oregon. And I was telling Felipe, you know, like one of the ways that I've really kind of shaken him up and challenged him to move with me in that process towards liberation is every time I saw him embodying his values and standing up for his humanity and for the humanity of others, I told him that he was beautiful. And I kept saying that for months and months until he understood what I was saying and continued saying it for months and months until he realized that I was directing those words towards him as a black man, and kept saying that for months and months until he was able to take ownership of the fact that yes, as a man, I can also be beautiful. As a black man, I can also be beautiful, and it's all right for me to claim those things for myself, reclaim that type of language. And the success for me this morning, after all of these years of having millions of conversations with him and interactions with him, is the point where like he actually texted me telling me that he loved me for being a friend in his life and for being a role model. And so I feel like the work that any of us can do in creating that process for people where they feel liberated from all of the restrictions they have on their gender, all of the restrictions that they have on their identity because of the journeys of their families and the things that they've fled from, the opportunities they've been seeking. That's, you know, that's the transformative change and social justice change that is really at the foundation of all of our work, regardless of what issue sector we're part of, regardless of what organization. I feel like that's at the core of where we should be moving and where I really want your help and your support, and thank you.
Right on.
Hi everyone, my name is Tania Unzueta. I'm from the Immigrant Youth Justice League in Chicago, also undocumented. My family and I came to this country when I was 10 years old with my sister who was 6 at the time. And for us, it was one of those things where it was like, well, let's see if we can get money over there to like eat and stuff. and then we kind of decided to stay here while my sister and I graduated high school, and then we ended up going to college, and then it was one of those things where we planned to go back every year, but it never really happened. And the way that I see it is, you know, the same thing that happens to a lot of us when we move, right, is that we grow roots wherever it is that we're at. And so that's what happened to us and my family, that we had friends, we became part of the community, we got involved in sports, we got involved in community organizing, we had friends, we met the people who we loved there, right? And so we stayed, and I and my family also tried. I think this whole thing about how you become undocumented and how you stop being undocumented is extremely like complicated, and everyone has their own different stories. We kind of joke about how there's different levels of undocumented people, because some of us have driver's license, some of us don't, social security is like all these kinds of things. But for us, so we're one of those families who migrated with a visa, who would also become legalized if I was to marry my partner of 5 years, if marriage was recognized with same-sex couples in the U.S. or whatever marriage, right, the rights of couples. Anyway, so we have tried to become citizens and regularize our status several times. One was through my dad's employer. He wanted to, you know, apply when 245i law or whatever was happening, and he, as he was applying, his employer was giving him everything, etc. The workers started to organize a union, and so my dad, like always being one of the people who supports workers, he was in like a supervisory position or something, and he ended up supporting the union. So the lawyers of his boss told them that, like, you know, it wasn't convenient for them to support his legalization process anymore, and so that ended. Myself, I was told by my school counselor that when I graduated from high school, I should apply as an international student, and I should go to Mexico to get my international student visa, which actually I did in 2001. I graduated from high school, went to Mexico, tried to get an international student visa, which they said no to because I'd been living in the U.S. undocumented. It was like a whole traumatic thing. I was 17 years old in Mexico without my family, and I was able to get back precisely because it was the same year that the Dream Act got introduced, and I think it was like politically like okay, and that was a story to illustrate the story, etc. Doesn't mean that I'm documented. I actually was in the country for 1 year with papers, and then that ran out, and like nothing ever happened. Actually, the day that I was supposed to be going to Congress to testify for the Dream Act, I had a plane ticket for September 11, 2001. And so, like, for me, very literally and historically, that's when a lot of immigration conversations stopped completely, like 10 years ago, and nothing has really happened until like the last year or so, where like real serious conversations are happening. So anyway, through that process, like when I came back right after high school, I wasn't out as LGBT yet. When I came back, I was like really starting to realize like what it meant for me to be undocumented, and how like all of my experiences connected with what everyone else was experiencing. And after September 11, 2001, I feel like I kind of went back into the shadows, as we kind of say it. I stopped talking about being undocumented very much, like in public, etc. And I started becoming more involved with the LGBT community. I went to college and I started coming out. I started dating girls, realizing that I was queer, and I sort of put my immigrant identity on the side. Right, I remember I was like dealing with my parents and with all of the things that we all have varied experiences, but that we deal with as LGBT people, right? And I remember like also being in college and not having to think about it until I was taking the sociology of immigration class, and we were all talking about what it meant to be an immigrant, and do immigrants contribute to society, etc. And people were talking about immigrants stealing jobs and not having this right, and do people have a right to control borders, etc. And it was all in this like third person conversation, right? They have this, they do that, I heard that, blah. And that's the moment when I felt I had to raise my hand and say, like, we can't keep talking about immigration in third person, right? Like, I have to say, I'm an immigrant, I'm undocumented, and like, okay, continue with your conversation. and that was for me the first time that I came out. It was in 2004 publicly as undocumented. And that's kind of when I started realizing, like, damn, like, one, like, this whole coming out strategy is pretty cool, right? Like, I started thinking, like, I was coming out as LGBT, I was learning about the LGBT movement, Harvey Milk, all of the gay liberation stuff in the 80s, connecting your identity to a political movement. But I realized that my movements were separate, were like they weren't together. Like, my parents were very involved in the immigrant rights movement, and I was very involved in the LGBT movement, and they didn't know each other. They were not friends. And it was around 2006 when we started thinking, like, okay, let's do something structural. I'm sorry, I feel like I'm getting into too many details, and I'll wrap up so that we can actually have some time for conversation. But the story that I want to tell is there was a moment where I felt like, as an LGBT activist, I needed to outreach the immigrant rights community. And in Chicago, the immigrant rights community includes my parents. And I was already out to my parents, but they had told me basically, like, let's not talk about it and everything will be fine. Just continue introducing me. Like, my mom told me that I should continue introducing my girlfriends as friends to her. And so for me, it was like, okay, like, if I'm really serious about this thing, about putting together LGBT and immigration, like, I kind of have to talk to my parents about this. And that was the first time that I closed my eyes, sent out an email, that was all gay and immigrant related. But anyway, so for me it was 2006 when I started putting together these two issues. But I wanted to just say a couple things about the work that we've been doing in Chicago. I recently started working with an LGBT immigrant rights coalition, and what we're trying to do is precisely put together these two issues so that we can work at a local level, but also at affecting national policy. And I want to talk to you, I actually made this handout, I have other copies if people want, but it lists out some of the reasons why immigrant rights are an LGBT issue. And the top one is that we are immigrants too, so we're like LGBT people are also immigrants, examples all around. And for us, like, that has been something really, really important that sometimes people forget. Number two, queer undocumented youth are fierce. And I think that, like, something that we haven't really, like, highlighted, but I think we're starting to, as undocumented young people, right, that, like, half of the Trail of Dreams is LGBT, half of IJL, the Immigrant Youth Justice League, is queer. When we did the civil disobedience in Arizona at Senator McCain's office, which Jahida participated in, I got arrested, and there were five of us, four of us were queer. And so the leadership of the Dream Act movement of undocumented youth is extremely gay. and LGBT, trans, queer, okay. But actually, and I say that, like, kind of lightly, but also not lightly, because that a lot of us, like, don't feel very connected to our gay identities, for example, precisely because we have tried to be in gay organizations or are in gay organizations, and often find that it's like an uphill battle, right, of just, like, getting people to stop using the word illegal, for example, or even to acknowledge that they're undocumented people, or to get involved with immigration policy. And so a lot of us, like, I don't know, tend to either go one or the other depending on what kind of support we need at the time, whether it's personal or political or whatever it is. But there, anyway, so that was number two. Number three, our families have limited options, as Felipe mentioned, right, because marriage isn't recognized at a national level, and not that marriage is the only issue that we need to be concerned with, but I mean, this means that we have less options as families. Number four was we can't help our immigrant partners. And I don't know if you've all heard of, like, the Obama administration's policy on deporting the partners of citizens who are same-sex partners, basically. And so right now there's all sorts of arguments around, like, who the Obama administration has a right to deport and not deport, right? Whether it's, like, Dream Act youth or it's criminals, blah, blah, blah. Well, one of those people who people are saying we shouldn't be deporting is the people who are married to or have a civil disobedience to a citizen. What did I say? A civil union, not a civil disobedience. Yes. or a marriage, right, to a citizen. And as far as we know, the Obama administration has continued to deport partners of same-sex citizens. And so the last, that's pretty much it that I want to say from here. But the last thing that I wanted to say is something related to identity. I think for a lot of us who are undocumented, like, it's been really important to be able to say it out loud, as Reyna was saying. And it's, I think that it's something that we just need to, I don't know how I want to, okay. I think as undocumented young people, we're asking the gay community to be our allies, right? And I think that we were doing this coming out event where we talked about being queer and undocumented, and someone in the audience put it best. She said something like, you know, my whole life I've been demanding all these things for my straight friends. She's like, as a queer person, I've been demanding for them to like go to events, to sign petitions, to be good allies to me. And she said, you know, this is the first time where I'm starting to think of myself as an ally. And I think that that's kind of what we're asking, that if you, like, the same things that you ask from your allies are the same things that we are asking from you if you're not an immigrant, right? That, like, that you use inclusive language, that you sign the petitions, that you go to events, that you talk about it, that you don't make jokes about it, that you don't use the word illegal. And so, you know, I don't know, I think it's sometimes hard for us who have been in oppressed populations to, like, think of ourselves as the part of the privileged ones, but that's kind of the idea. And so, anyway, that's it. Thank you.